Praise the Lord and good morning. We bring you greetings from Apostolic Church of Jesus in the great city of Detroit on the west side. Amen. We're here today to for Sunday school, and the title of our Sunday school lesson is A Light for the Gentiles. It is lesson number 12, and today's date is May 17th in the year 2020. And the Sunday school book that we're using is the Christian Life Series United Gospel Press. For those that who don't have a book or who would like to know where we are teaching from, and if you want to look it up on the internet or Google it, it's United Gospel Press. It's lesson 12, May 17th, 2020. And before we get started, let's take a minute for prayer. Let's bow our heads. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you for this moment you have given us to come into your house to lift up your name on high. Lord, we ask you just bless all those that hear the word. Give them continued understanding, concern of thy word. Help us to make application of thy word, Lord. Let thy word go forth, Lord. We ask these blessings and all blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So we hope that as many as can have tuned in thus far. And again, the lesson is lesson 12, May 17, 2020. And the title is A Light for the Gentiles. So I'm going to read the golden text. It is a light thing that thou shouldest be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved of Israel. I will also give thee for a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation until the end of the earth. Now, in reading this lesson, it's kind of funny. I used to hear my pastor say that no matter what scripture you read in the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, wherever you're reading, you should be able to see Jesus. No matter what you're reading, you should be able to see Jesus in it. And during this time, you know, this COVID-19, I've been home a lot. I've been doing a lot of reading, more than I normally do. You know, you have a lot of free time, so I've been reading more than I normally do. And it's funny now, I can hear him, and I heard him say his pastor or his father told him the same thing, that it's Jesus from Genesis to Revelation, from the beginning and the end to the scripture, it's Jesus. This book is about Jesus. And then this lesson, I kept seeing. I mean, it was like, wow, it was just mind-blowing to me when I read a scripture, then I do a little research, and I read this and read that, and you say it's Jesus. And in the scripture, in the lesson, it's talking about, it says, it is a light thing that thou shouldst be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob. Well, when you think of Jesus, the first thing that come to mind is not a servant. That's not a servant. That's not the first thing that come to my mind. But if we go to I think it's Philippians, the second chapter. Let me pull that up. Philippians, the second chapter. Trying to find Philippians, the second chapter. Just one second. Should have had this written down. Philippians, the second chapter, started in the fifth verse. It says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon the form of a servant. It says he took upon the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even to the cross. So Jesus took upon the form of a servant. And I kept seeing him in this lesson. He took a form of a servant. So many times when folk come into church, they come out to the church like this, like, what can you do for me? But Jesus came not to be served, but to serve. So when we come to the church, we should be coming to the church saying, what can I do to help the church? But so many times we come, what can the church do for me? We looking to receive from the church. But it should be, what can I do for the church? We're looking, so if he came as a servant, then we're his servants. So we are servants also. We have in our mind, I find, even myself, we want to be served, we want to be catered to, we want this to be done for us. But it says, he formed himself to be a servant, even unto death, for you and me. He died on the cross for you and me. That's the ultimate sacrifice. That's the ultimate servant, to die for someone. And yet we come to his house looking for something, saying, what do I need to go to church for? What the church got for me? What do you have for God? It's nothing that you can give God, but at least you can serve him. You can find out what it is that he require of you. You can be baptized in his name and be filled with the Holy Ghost and try to live humbly and holy before him. So that thing servant kind of stuck out in my mind. Let's get to the reading of our lessons. Listen, O isles, unto me, and hearken, ye people, from far. The Lord called me from the womb, from the bowels of my mother, he hath made mention of my name. He hath made my mouth like a sharp sword, and in the shadow of his hand, he hid me and made me a polished shaft and quivered me. Now it says, he hath made my mouth like a sharp sword, in the shadow of his hand he hath hid me. Now, the understanding I have when it says he hath made my mouth, in John 1:1, the scripture tells us, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was made flesh. So in the beginning was the Word, and that's the Word that it's talking about when it says he hath made my mouth like a sharp sword. He's talking about the Word that comes out of his mouth, because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was made flesh, and the Word dwelled among men. A sharp sword says it was polished. And I work in a factory, but I work in a machining area. And when you're dealing with sharp edges, it has to be smooth. It's like a knife. A knife doesn't have any burrs on it. You want it sharpened so it'll be completely smooth, and you want to polish it so it have no imperfections in that sword. So that when that sword comes through, it's coming through clean and nice, and it'll make a nice sharp edge. Any imperfections on that surface is going to slow it down, or it's going to create imperfections or deformities or deformation and whatever is cutting. So when that Word comes across, it's coming across sharp. His Word is, it comes across not only to just to punish, to destroy, but it comes to bring hope. It comes to give eternal life. It comes to lift us up. You know, when you think of a sharp sword, you think of the Word thing. A sharp sword can destroy you. It can kill you. It can punch you. But the Word of God can lift you up. It can build you up. It can make you stronger. Amen. And he said unto me, Thou art my servant, O Israel, in whom I will be glorified. Then I said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for naught and in vain. Yet surely my judgment is with the Lord, and my work with God. Now said the Lord that formed me from the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob again to him. Though Israel be not gathered, yet shall I be glory in the eyes of the Lord. My God shall be my strength. Now, in verse 5, it's talking about Jacob and Israel. And I don't know if you remember, back in Sunday school, we were taught about, is it Isaac and Rebekah's son, Esau and Jacob, about the birthright. I think that's in Genesis somewhere. I think it's around the 25th chapter. I'm not going to go too deep in it. But I think God told him that told Rebekah that she had two nations in her stomach. And it was Esau and Jacob, and I think Jacob was the younger one. Esau was the older one. I can't remember, but I know it's in Genesis 25, I think around the 23rd verse. If you get a chance, you can go back and read it. But it's talking about Esau and Jacob, and when God told her the two nations that was in my belly in the first verse of the lesson, when he said, he made mention of my name it says, call me from the womb and the bowels of my mother have he made mention of my name. And talking about Esau and Jacob, he will bring it together. It's saying Esau and Jacob, but it's actually talking about two nations that God is going to bring together. Because this whole lesson is talking about the servant, whom is Jesus, who wants to rise up the tribe of Jacob and restore Israel and bring them back together. But also, he wants to do something greater than that. He wants to bring all nations. He wants to bring the Gentiles back also. Yes, Israel is God's chosen people. But when he died on the cross, not only did he die for the Jews, he died for all mankind. So no one can have, you have not an excuse not to serve God, because when he died for all. Amen. In the sixth verse, it says, and he said, it is a light thing that thou shouldest be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserve of Israel. I will also give thee for a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be salvation unto the end of the earth. Now I want to read this, Isaiah 60, starting at the first verse. Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall rise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles shall come to the light, and the king to the brightness of thy rising. Lift up thy eyes round about and see. All they gather themselves together and come to thee. Thy sons shall come from far, and thy daughters shall be nursed at thy side. Then thou shalt see and flow together, and thy heart shall fear and be enlarged, because the armies of the sea shall be converted unto thee, and the forces of the Gentiles shall come unto thee. So not only does Jesus want to save the Jews, he want to save the Gentiles. In the first verse it says, listen, O islands, unto me, and hearken, ye people from afar. He is talking about all nations. God died and shed his blood so that all mankind could be saved. He died for me, you, he, him, and her. He wanted us all to be saved. Not just me, but all mankind. He said, from afar. He's calling all his people back together. And it's funny, it makes me think that, you know, during this time of this pandemic, you have nothing to do but to call on Jesus. It's in his hand. They don't have a cure. It's something that we never seen before. We never experienced. So it's no past practice that we can look back what we did in the past and see, okay, this is what we'll do this time. None of that has happened before. So the only thing we can do is look to Jesus. Could be that Jesus put this out to get the world attention, especially the church. Wake up, church. He's saying that the scripture tells us that Jesus is coming back. No man knows the day nor the hour. But maybe Jesus is just giving us a warning. All nations, those that are here and near and those that are far, he's coming back. He's giving us a warning. Get ready, church. If you stay ready, you won't have to get ready. And if you stay ready, you'll be ready. But if you ain't ready, when he comes, he's coming like a thief in the night, and you will be left here. You will be left here. But he gives us a warning. He has our undivided attention now. Because who else do you have to look to? It's only Jesus. I hear so many different testimonies of different ones from all over the world saying how they survived this thing. Some was in a hospital for 30 days, 40 days, 50 days, all different amount of times. And they're thinking and praising God. But even after all is over, is we going to fall back into our old ways? Are we going to go back into doing what we always been doing? That's not what God wants us to do. God don't want us to go back to our old ways. It's like a dog turning back to his vomit. You don't want to do that. Why would you regurgitate something and then go back to it? That's nasty. That's filth. Well, when you get baptized in Jesus' name and get filled with the Holy Ghost and you go back and continue to sin, that's what you're doing. It's nasty. It's filthy. God wants his people to turn from their wicked ways. In 2 Chronicles, in the 7th chapter, I think starting around the 11th verse, it said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, and then shall I heal the land. God is the only one that can heal the land. He is the creator of heaven and earth. So he has the vaccine to cure each and every one of us. He has the all power in his hand, all power in heaven and earth. He's the only one that can make a way out of no way. So we should be looking to him. Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith. Jesus is the beginning and the end of mankind. He said, there's no God before me and there's none after. I'm the beginning and the end. I'm Alpha and Omega. Acts 4 and 12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And that name is Jesus. That's the only name that we can be saved by. It's power in the name of Jesus. It's power in the name of Jesus. If you don't know, now you know. Y'all funny. Amen. So, and he said, then I said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for naught in vain. Yet surely my judgment is with the Lord and my work with my God. I'm not a pastor. I'm not a preacher. But being in church, I see pastors sometimes, they get frustrated. I see that all the preaching and teaching that they do, sometimes they think that their labor is in vain. That the folk is not hearing. People don't want to do right. People don't want to come to church. They don't want to serve God. They don't want to live holy. You know, sometimes we think that we're 3 times 7 and we can just do what we want to do. We want to do what we want to do. I pay my own bills. I get up and go to work in the morning. So I'm going to do what I want to do. But the scripture tells us, lean not to your own understanding, acknowledge him in all your ways, and he shall direct your path. So your ways ain't God's ways. It says, in all that getting, get some understanding. There's so many people in this world that's walking around that have no idea of what's going on. They don't have a clue. You know, people say, you tell somebody about heaven, ain't no heaven, ain't no hell. Well, I'm in hell right now. You have no idea. If you think this is heaven, you're in trouble. If you think this is hell, you're in trouble. You better get some understanding of what's going on. And he didn't just leave us empty-handed. He left us the word. Again, John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the word. So this is the word that he left us to go by, to live by. And I hear folks say, well, man wrote the Bible. But if this is what God left us, then this is what we must go by. Lean not to your own understanding. Don't trust yourself. Do not trust yourself. Do not lean into this flesh. This flesh is weak. It's going to do what it want to do. It's going to go with its own desires. We done?
Yeah, one more minute.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I thought my time was up. Amen. So I hope this lesson was encouraging. I hope I said something to encourage someone. If you have any thoughts or comments, you can call or you can send them via email, or you can come down to the church. Again, we're in the city of Detroit. We're on Plymouth Road. Any questions or comments? Right now, our plan is to be back in service in the building. I think it's May 31st or June 1st. But we will give weekly updates on that, depending on how the governor continue to have the lockdown on. Amen.
But when Adam bit of the tree, heaven doors closed, and we had no more access to God.